Good morning, everyone. I'm so thrilled you all are here today. I'm Reverend Kelly Wheat Rivers, the Associate Minister at our wonderful UU congregation here. And today is a really special day for me because I get to join my spouse, as some of you know, my spouse for 20 years. on the chancel this morning. And today is a special day. It's a pride service. And it just reflects to me the core of the values we hold as Unitarian Universalists, holding people's worth and dignity at the core of who we are. So we welcome you to this sanctuary and worship service, as well as those joining online. Hi, Zoomers. We hope that in this congregation and sacred space, wherever it may be, that you will be strengthened by spiritual encouragement and find comfort from those joining with you in worship. As we enter into worship, please take a moment to make sure your cell phones are on silent. She follows her own directions. To everyone who is familiar to this congregation and to everyone new, you are welcomed with love. If you are in person, we are invited to stop in the vestibule at the welcome table if you want to learn more about Unitarian Universalism as a whole or about this congregation in particular. And if you're in person or online, we encourage you to go to our newcomers page on our website. We also have an Instagram page and a Facebook page. You can poke around and see what we're about. Now I'd like to invite anybody who is visiting who might want to introduce themselves. If you're comfortable doing so, to stand and introduce yourself so we can welcome you more fully. So I'm just going to open it up to the whole room. If there's anybody new that would like to introduce themselves, let me know. Right here, oh, right here in the middle. I'll get to you, Michael. Go ahead.
Hi, I'm Beth.
Hi. Oh, then you're super brave.
This is our second time here, so we count on Zoom 1 week.
We count it. Did you say Beth?
Yes.
Beth and Kevin.
Yes.
Hi, welcome. I'm so glad you're here. Sir Michael. Michael and Robbie. And we did the math earlier. You said married 27 years because we did math. Is there anybody else who would like to introduce themselves? Well, I'm so glad y'all are here today. We have a weekly digest that goes out every Thursday. It is a very fantastic way to find out about all the things going on in our congregation. We have some people. Come on in. We're here for announcements. Come on in. If you don't get the digest and you would like to, if you stop by the welcome table, there's something that you can fill out and you'll get information weekly about all the things that are going on. Today, instead of our normal eat and gather in Dobkin Hall in our fellowship hall, we're having our annual potluck picnic right across the street that way to Longleaf Park shelter number 4. So it's going to be after the service, and bring a treat, share, spend time with us. It's a really fun time and a way to get to know people. And then our final announcement is Michael Sheridan is coming up to tell us about some important work.
Good morning, everybody. I'm here to just remind you about two time-sensitive opportunities to support our Democracy and Voting Rights Project. The first is an upcoming voter empowerment training, which is happening here tomorrow from 5:30 to 7. Pizza's happening from 5:30 to 6, and the training is from 6 to 7. We'd really like to have a good turnout, and we need to know how much pizza to order. So we can sign you up at the picnic. Where's Pam? Oh, she's still out there. She has her laptop with her, so you don't even have to take anything away. She'll just sign you up right there. So we're hoping you can make it. The training is going to be by You Can Vote, and they do a great job. Yes, they do. And there's still time to send an email to your county commissioners. If you did the email related to the voting hours, that's email 1, this is email 2, about adequate funding. And I have handouts here. It's really simple. People are taking like 2 to 5 minutes to do it at most. And we'll also have some of these at the picnic as well. And both of these will count toward our action goal. And just to give you an up count, an update, we're up to 196 actions at this point. So let's get over 200, okay? Thanks.
All right, and now let us take a moment to settle ourselves, to open our hearts and minds to the worship that will bring us together this morning. Today's service is focused on Pride Month, but I would feel remiss if I didn't acknowledge that Wednesday is Juneteenth, the anniversary of 1865 when the word of freedom reached the last enslaved people in Texas. After I ring the chimes, there will be a moment of silence before the prelude begins. During this time, I invite you to meditate on all those lives that were wrongfully taken, abused, and treated as less than human. Those lives that are not credited or even considered, but are largely responsible when we talk about the development and success of our young nation. For without them, the nation would not have been built as quickly or solidly. We recognize their unwilling yet important contribution, and we are here willing to do the work we must continue to do to recognize them and fix the broken systems that continue to take advantage of and to disadvantage their ancestors today.
Thank you.
For those of you not aware, there's an LGBT youth group that has used our space for meetings for several years. We have received permission from them to use some of their writings in today's service under their pen names. One of those is our unison chalice lighting. If you'll please join me in that as Susanna and Phineas light our chalice. In the cruel social norms of each day, a queer soul treads a path thought to be astray, where love's expression is met with fear, homophobia's whispers painfully clear. Transphobia lurks in a family's glance, a silent rejection not given a chance. Mental health struggles, a hidden weight, in the mind's shadows they silently abate. Depression's subtle hand leaves its mark, causing of problems unplanned. Yet amidst the turmoil, a spirit resilient finds solace in moments, a small sense of fulfillment. Every moment, a hope renewed, in the face of adversity, courage pursued. Let us stand united and bold, in the face of bigotry, truth be told. For in the day-to-day battles we face, resides a strength that cannot be erased. All right, and now if everyone would stand as willing and able, we'll sing our first hymn, number 1053 from the Teal Hymnals, How Could Anyone?
That was one of the first songs that I heard in a UU congregation that made my ears perk up and think, this is different. I would love to invite all the kiddos who would like to come down to the front for our story time. If you did not grab a pillow, we have some extras up here because this is not the friendliest floor. So if you would love to come up, our story is called "'Twas the Night Before Pride." "'Twas the night before Pride, a warm evening in June, all the people got ready with the rise of the moon. The drag queens all brushed their wigs with great care, and the bikers checked their tires to make sure they had air. All across the city, people's outfits were planned and the instruments polished for the queer marching band. My mom told us all we should go to bed early. She's that kind of mom who's more boyish than girly. While Mama finished packing our snacks in a bag, Sammy started chewing on the edge of our flag. As I finished my sign, which I laid on the floor, I remembered the prides I'd been to before. All day we will walk in the streets up and down. Pride's one of the best celebrations around. There are floats and loud music and rainbows and glitter. Last year we ran into our babysitter. Tomorrow will be baby Sammy's first pride. Can we tell the whole story? I hopefully cried. So we sat on the couch, a mom on each side, and took turns telling the tale of the very first pride. A long time ago, in 1969, there wasn't a Pride March. It was a less fair time. Queer people all over of each shape and size didn't have any rights recognized. So much of their lives they had to keep hidden. Even their clothing was sometimes forbidden. Stonewall was a place where it was safe to be proud, but police would storm in to say this wasn't allowed. So one hot night in June, people stopped being quiet. They decided to fight and started a riot. More and more gathered to fight back in the heat. Some started a kick line in the middle of the street. Police broke up the crowd night after night, but the people stood strong, knowing this wasn't right. And so it began, a march that spread worldwide to show everyone it's good to have pride. It sometimes happens we're not given respect. It can take a long time for some to accept. That's why every year we all get together and march in the streets, no matter the weather, to know that we matter, to show all we exist, and that any oppression we must always resist. So Pride's not just about tutus and rainbow suspenders. It's about rights for queers and all our beautiful genders. Pride's a day that is crowded. It's a day that is long. It's a day that means together we are strong. As I close my eyes, I thought of Pride's past. Pride means to me being yourself is a blast. So tomorrow, I will march with my family and cheer. Happy Pride to all. It's great my family is here. And now will you all please sing with me as we sing our kids off to their classroom. Mwah. Love you, sweet girl. Y'all, we had enough kids to sing it through two times. Come on now. We have three readings this morning. I will start, and then we will have two other of our beautiful people in our congregation coming to read the second and third. These are from our Pride Youth Group. Not to be a Debbie Downer, but being trans kind of sucks. You'll get people who think you're weird. You'll hear opinions about how gay you look when you just want to get the mail. You'll get the same dumbfounded expression as you explain the simple concept of your existence to people who are unwilling to listen. And you'll have to hear someone spout the same dumb, hateful words they heard their friends say.
Growing up, you are taught social norms about how you are supposed to present yourself or who you are supposed to love. And if you don't comply with those social norms, you feel different than everyone else. So you try to fit in by being someone you're not. You might end up feeling alone and like there's no one else like you. Eventually, you will learn that there are people like you and people who do understand what you are going through and not judge you for being different than what society sees as normal. It can be hard, but there will always be people who understand and will support you.
For much of my life, I felt a bit lost. I never fit into the standard binary system, and for the first 13 years of my life, didn't know what I was. I was never a girl or a boy. I am neither and both. I now understand why I always took such pride in confusing people. Many people that I know would refer to me as a girl, whereas when I'm out and about, often people refer to me as a boy. This variety always made me happy. It felt right. Looking back at my life, I now know why I hated the question so much, are you a girl or a boy? It was because I didn't like the fact that those were my only options. Those felt suffocating and they didn't feel right. I always found it hilarious when my friend would wait for me to correct people when they used he or him when talking about me. I never did correct them. In a world viewed blue and pink, nothing else is seen. No purple, periwinkle, or magenta allowed. Fitting in takes more effort than it's worth. It takes too much mentally, physically, emotionally. Personally, I would rather be me, in whatever form that may take. I would rather cut my hair the way I want, wear the clothes I want. I would rather be who I want, be who I am. Alexander Tewksbury III.
Now is the time for our candles of joys and sorrows. Ours is a proud and welcoming community where we find connection, a spiritual community where we find meaning. Ours is a sharing community where our joys are amplified, a caring community where our sorrows are lessened. We will now take time to reflect on our joys and sorrows and support each other. You are invited to come to the front and light a candle or place a shell in our Riverstone fountain. If you are online, please feel free to enter your personal joys and concerns in the chat box. As our friends come forward, let us sing our compassion to them with hymn number 123, Spirit of Life.
Light one more candle for all the joys and sorrows that are just not ready to be shared in any way yet. Will you all please join me in a time of reflection and prayer? Spirit of love, of rainbows and joy and glitter. Spirit of love, hard won, fought for, appreciated. Let us never take for granted the spaces where we can be wholly and authentically ourselves. And I pray for all those who are still searching for it, that they find it in a kind action, a loving word, a listening ear, willing to hear all of who we are. May this sanctuary be a sacred place, welcoming to people on their spiritual journey, wherever it may be. And may we go into the world reflecting that love, that joyous, abounding, non-judgmental love that so many people need. And on this day of Father's Day, a day that can be joyful or fraught with emotions, I pray for all of those who have lost their father figures, don't have father figures, have a strained relationship, and also for those who have loving fathers, may this be a day where all of our feelings can be acknowledged. May we reflect love inward to ourselves and outward to the world. In the name of all that is holy, amen.
Welcome to Pride Month, y'all. I love this most colorful of months. Many of you comment on my bright clothes throughout the year, but this is full rainbow time. It's a month of celebration of the full human experience. It is a time for mourning for the lack of freedoms and for those that have been lost. A time to remember the riots that got us here. A time to rally. A time to be in a community. It is a month to feel seen and accepted more fully than any other time. It's a time to be proud. We are a welcoming congregation. We say these words fairly consistently. And they're not just empty words. We've actually completed the steps laid out by the UUA to get certified as a welcoming congregation. And we are in process of renewing that now. We actively work to encourage and welcome those in the queer community. And so I am proud of this congregation. When I was growing up, my personal knowledge of the queer community was limited to words like gay, lesbian, and the now outdated terms transvestite or transsexual. Now there are a lot more identities that I'm aware of under the queer umbrella, and it can be hard to keep up. We have the original letters still of LGBTQ, which I imagine most of you know, but we also have agender, asexual, aromantic, non-binary, agender, pansexual, sapphic, intersex, questioning, and so many more. It's okay if you can't keep up with them all. You don't need to. The identities there are more for the people who claim them than they are for allies. As an ally, you just have to love people where they are and remember our first UU principle of the worth and dignity of all humans. Last year, I realized that I was non-binary. This was still a newer term in my knowledge base, but it really started to resonate with me. For those that don't know, that means that I don't follow the accepted gender binary, even though I usually present as male. I feel more separated from either gender than a part of one. Non-binary technically falls under the trans umbrella, but I don't really feel part of the trans community. I don't feel like I'm transitioning from one thing to another. I don't have the body dysmorphia that a lot of trans people do, but this is my experience as non-binary, and any non-binary person will tell you that we all experience it differently. I have always felt a pull in that direction, even though I didn't know what that direction was. You see, I've always had a hard time assigning gender to anything, or even naming anything that I had to come up with a name for, whether it be life roles or skills, clothing, interests, hobbies. None of these assigned gender norms ever made sense to me. I was equally happy playing sports, learning to farm, learning to cook, or learning to sew. And while I very much grew up a boy, I was maybe just a little bit different. There's a song called Confrontations that I have been listening to a lot lately, and one line in particularly really resonates with me. And now my life is a series of confrontations between my traits and the ones I was faking. Sometimes I feel like I was faking some of the more masculine traits that were assigned to me so that I might fit into my assigned gender role. I don't understand why things have a gender assigned to them. Throughout history, people have crossed those imaginary gender lines and they have moved. And so why are we still so surprised by it? I don't stand up here to make this proclamation about myself because I feel the need to come out to you all. To me, that's like introducing yourself as heterosexual or cisgender to everyone you meet. And for those that don't know, cisgender is just that those that identify or relate to the gender you are assigned at birth. I don't think it needs to be a thing, unless maybe you have some romantic aspirations for the person you're telling. I say it from this place of power for the kids that wrote these letters, and for the people who need to know that they are not alone. There are more of us here, and we welcome you with open arms. Trans people and people that live their non-cisgender identities visibly are frequently unsafe in public places. These kids deserve to feel safe. I want to feel safe. When I feel more feminine, I want to feel safe expressing that anywhere I go. The Human Rights Council has tracked fatal violence against the trans community since 2013. These numbers aren't always easy to track because of how people are reported or not reported as trans. This year, as of mid-May, 16 trans people had been murdered. In 2023, there were 32, and 84% of those were people of color. So people already in other oppressed populations are more affected. 36% of those were murdered by a partner or a family member. So the one place they are supposed to be safe, they're not. And 50% of those murdered were misgendered and deadnamed by the press and authorities. So the public is not honoring the person who died, but the person they used to be seen as. They're not honoring their memory. And these numbers are just reported the number of murders. They do not include suicides that stem from bullying and being disowned. They don't account for overdoses, kidnappings, and other things that happen with runaways that leave in an uninhabitable home. They don't include violence that doesn't end in death. I imagine those numbers are much more extreme. I feel safer than a lot of trans people. I grew up in full white male privilege. I still present that way, so I still receive all the privilege that comes with that. So in some ways, I have imposter syndrome. It sometimes feels like any discrimination against me must be in my head. It feels like my participation in the LGBT community is on the outskirts and that I'm basically an ally. But I also know that as I continue presenting this way, it's because of safety. I won't likely be attacked in public, verbally or physically. I won't have fights with my family that have never been exposed to someone like me. And you've probably noticed I've been focusing on transgender people today, and that's because they are under attack. All across the nation, bills are being introduced to stop access to gender-affirming care. And as seen over the past decade, when politics start saying it's okay to attack something, bills can turn into prejudice, and then hate, and then violence. The more worth and dignity a group of people is questioned is in politics and in the media, the larger this problem will become. And it's not like trans people have ever felt safe here, at least not since colonization. I am proud to be queer, and I am proud to be part of this congregation. I'm not sure I would have fully explored my feelings of being non-binary if it wasn't for this place. You all make me feel safe. I know there are some great queer organizations and places in the country, but for me, this is the safest public space that I can imagine being comfortable being wholly and truly myself. Which means I think you are all doing a great job of making this a safe, welcoming space. And I hope we continue to lead others on that journey. So at the same time that we love and protect these individuals, we have to be fighting for their community as a whole. As our social justice ministry is going to be preaching until Election Day, we have to do more. Yes, you must vote yourself, but the time has come to do more than that. So far, we've taken more than one action per member of this congregation to support democracy. We will have many more opportunities for that. As Michael mentioned, tomorrow night is the next one. We will have a democracy party later this year. We will write postcards to people that have not been voting, and some of the people around you are volunteering with other groups and going door to door to get votes. There is a role for everyone, and there is work we must get done. As much as we all dread some of the outcomes of November, these kids will face consequences much longer than we will. The brave and beautiful children that wrote these letters we are sharing today need us to do more. Please use your voice, use your privilege, and use your vote.
Thank you for being a space where my spouse can explore who they are and be loved for it. Our closing hymn today is number 1012 in our teal hymnal, When I Am Frightened. Please rise as you are willing and able. Something I wanted to share with you all, and I just got permission about Dan's journey, is that it came up in conversation with Emma, our daughter, recently about different identities. When Emma was smaller, she said she would call herself Emir at times, and she would tell us that she was a boy. Cool. We went with it because Emma knows herself better. So whether she was Emir or Emma. And one night before bed, she and I were talking more about different identities, and we started talking about non-binary identities, and Dan texted me from the front of the house, should I come back there? And I said, yeah, I think you should. And Dan shared with Emma that they were non-binary. And our 8-year-old daughter, who is being raised in this sacred space, gave Dan the biggest hug and just said, "Thank you for sharing that with me. Thank you for telling me about yourself." So we are doing some amazing work here. The fact that our 8-year-old, that was her default setting, is pretty amazing. Whew, okay. Thanks to the dedication and hard work of our Share the Plate team, we donated $745.33, that always cracks me up, to UU Justice NC. This week's Share the Plate goes to Humanity Now Direct Refugee Relief. Humanity Now finds low-cost and practical solutions to help improve the daily lives of refugees and displaced people. Each year, this Wilmington-based group of women head to refugee camps in Greece and Poland with funds raised during the previous 12 months. Please note, the volunteers pay all their own expenses, including travel. All donations go directly to helping refugees. Last year, the group raised $109,000 for small-scale targeted funding that will have as a significant impact on the lives of many, from refrigeration for food distribution to the building of a bomb shelter schoolroom for displaced children in Ukraine to a 5-day summer camp in Poland for disabled refugee children, and so much more. What a wonderful opportunity to see our donations help these vulnerable children and their families, giving them help and hope and a sense of humanity now. If you are contributing by check, please put STP in the memo field, and you can also text your donation to the number on the screen or donate to Share the Plate directly from our website under the Donate tab. Would the ushers please come forward to take this morning's collection?
Thank you.
Our closing words today is a responsive reading. Today, Pride Day, we affirm with joy that we are proud.
We are proud to be lesbian, gay, bisexual, trans, queer, and questioning.
We are proud to have survived and thrived despite challenges to our dignity, well-being, and sometimes even our lives.
We are proud to be heterosexual and cisgender allies.
We are proud to live and work in solidarity with our LGBTQ friends and family.
Together, we build the beloved community.
We and those we love have been judged, mistreated, assaulted.
But we are here, and we are proud.
We and those we love have been stereotyped and have faced discrimination.
But we are here, and we are proud.
We have seen those we love beaten to death and gunned down.
But we are here, and we are proud.
We are together, and we are proud.
And together, we will the beloved community watch as it grows among us even now.
Thanks. Thanks, Kat.
It truly takes a village to put together a service, and there was a lot involved in today. Thank you to the choir and the musicians for all the lovely music they provided. Thank you to my readers and chalice lighters for the service they provided today. And we have so many people with greeters and welcome table, hospitality putting together the picnic across the street at the moment, so don't forget to go to that, and the vergers, and of course my worship associate. So thank you to everyone that made this service possible. And now, if you'll join us in extinguishing the chalice with the words on the screen.
We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth. Please watch your hair. Warmth of community or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again. And now I invite you to rise, connect with hands and arms across the aisles. We call it our amoeba of connection as we sing together our song of peace.